we set out to build something that was based on privacy first mm-hmm. principles way before GDPR, mm-hmm. where people, they had to give us consent for us to process the data.
Yeah.
So even our PFM map, we never shared data behind the back in mm-hmm. any case, mm-hmm. right? Everything we did was transparent. Everything was based on that you own the data, and but you want to share it to, mm-hmm. to other parties to gain advantage of that.
So I picked up a couple of times in our conversation that you make an emphasis on quality. So do you think that perhaps the slow uptake at the very beginning on this first wave of open banking and perhaps a hesitance to adopt it was related to the lack of quality in the APIs and the interfaces?
Yes, most surely. When these APIs were launched in September 19, mm-hmm. most of them actually didn't work
yeah.
as products, right? You might be able to log in, you might be able to see some data, mm. but then at scale, it didn't work, or even the data that was provided wasn't the right data and so forth. So a lot has been fixed mm-hmm. over the last couple of years. But on top of that, I would also say that the way companies service companies that want to take advantage of open banking mm-hmm. has also still a lot to do.
Yeah.
And I think when I talk quality, I actually talk quality in terms of quality of service mm-hmm. and quality of technology.
Yeah.
And both has to be in place because it's still a fairly new field. Mm-hmm. And you have to ensure that the ones that are consuming your services actually build something that goes live.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you don't have volume enough to help the APIs become the quality you want. Mm-hmm. So you're, on one side, you need to bring customers to live while you have APIs that constantly have to be raised in terms of quality maturity. Mm-hmm. And you can only do that by delivering great service on both hands, right?
Yeah.
So I think that's probably what we have been trying to build here in the Nordics and that we are exporting to the rest of Europe right now is that model where quality of service goes hand in hand with quality of technology.
And that's precisely where I wanted to take my next question. Tell us a little bit more about Aiia and what makes you different than other companies that perhaps are providing API services.
We have, since we launched the company back in 2010 mm-hmm. and created one of the first aggregators here in Europe and the first to appear in the Nordics, mm-hmm. We set out to build something that was based on privacy-first mm-hmm. principles. Way before GDPR, mm-hmm. where people, they had to give us consent for us to process the data.
Yeah.
So even our PFM map, we never shared data behind the back in mm-hmm. any case, mm-hmm. right? Everything we did was transparent. Everything was based on that you own the data, and but you want to share it to other parties to gain advantage of that. So that transparency, we took that into to the setup of Aiia as well, mm-hmm. and then providing that for businesses that are customers with us, right? So they can trust that we not only store data, but also act on top of GDPR, and even further than that, make sure that we don't kind of bring the ones that own the account and that in the end is sharing the data, which is the end users. Mm-hmm. They should always be in control of this. So that principle has led to a lot of different technologies. So we, for enterprise customers, for instance, we can work as a pure data processor mm-hmm. where we don't store any data at all. We just act as, you could say, dumb pipes that mm-hmm. acts upon instruction. And once that instruction has been completed, there's no trace of anything happened mm-hmm. in our nets. Banks, they really like that part. For SMEs, we have a different product where we have something called Aiia Hub, where you can share as an end user. You can set up your sharing in there. So you get an overview of which accounts did you set up for sharing, with which services are you sharing them, for what purposes. Mm-hmm. You can revoke that access directly from this tool. But you can also get like a centralized view on, okay, when did service what retrieve what kind of information from you, which service did perform a payment, and so forth. So you can be totally in control, right? You get all the levers of control directly in your own hands, something that goes way beyond PSD2.
Mm-hmm.
On the other part, it's like security and compliance, being very focused on from day one to understand that Europe is not Europe. Europe is still 27/28 different countries with their own legislations, their own lawmakers, their own NCAs and so forth.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the future of Aiia. Of course, we're all aware of the recent news about the Mastercard's acquisition of Aiia. Can you tell us a little bit about what led to that acquisition taking place?
Yeah, so when we looked at the model we built for open banking, we started out building in the Nordics together with Nordic banks to make sure that we kind of controlled all the elements that were out of control in the beginning. And once we got that model in place, we started looking to the European scope and mm-hmm. saying, like, how can we roll out fast to the rest of Europe? And we did a lot on our own. So we connect to 2,900 banks now. We are available in 18 markets in Europe mm-hmm. already. But in order to grow even faster, we started looking for a third investor.
Yeah,
we had like Danske Bank and DNB as investors at that time. A third investor to bring us faster to the rest of the European markets. So it was kind of like a search for a distribution partner
mm-hmm.
and perhaps even a technology partner at the same time. And then we stressed that it wouldn't kind of hurt us if it was a payment
mm-hmm.
company either. And then a year ago or so, I started talking to guys from Mastercard. And at that time, I realized that they were actually executing fairly fast on a strategy they called multi-rail.
Uh-huh.
The Mastercard, they want to be part of any payment that happens.
Yep.
Not only card payments, but also direct debits that happens on like proprietary direct debit platforms, mm-hmm. Open banking payments, and also the data part, being able to use data to even further secure the payment itself, but also to give leverage for lending situations and so forth, was on top of the agenda.
Mm-hmm.
And they had been searching for a partner that took compliance and security and quality as their primary concerns, right?
Mm-hmm.
And when we started talking and we started like talking about Aiia Hub and these things they just resonated with Mastercard. And on the other hand, when they started talking about what they had been doing in the US, buying Finicity over there,
mm-hmm.
and how they were looking at the whole space of payments, not open banking necessarily, but space of payments moving more and more into the digital realm itself, we started seeing a lot of synergies.
Mm-hmm.
And even though Mastercard is a huge company and we're still a fairly small company, right, getting to the 100-man team, what we could see is the way they developed technologies, the way they constructed their organization in terms of developing technologies was something that matched with our capabilities.
Mm-hmm.
So I think at some point during that dialogue, it changed from being about an investment into what would happen if we kind of like just put the foot on the speeder and just pulled full throttle.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the kind of talk about merging or even like having Mastercard acquiring us came up.
So it seems that this was not just a matter of gaining new capabilities, but the way you describe it, there was a meeting of the minds or a meeting of the mindset of both organizations that was very compatible.
I personally really, really get inspired by is that from ground to top at Mastercard, they share the same vision. I had dialogues with Michael Miebach that was about like data privacy,
mm-hmm.
about the ability to benefit consumers of the future with data, with payments and so forth, and had the same kind of talks with tech people from Mastercard.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And that's very correspondent to how we run this company.
Right.
There's no difference, like as me as a CEO and a developer, it's the same thing we want, right?
Mm-hmm.
We want the quality, we want the compliance, and we want this rolled out fast because we believe that it's the future of financial services.
Okay, and so in your view, how will the end consumer, the person on the street with a bank account and a card for payments or a mobile account, how will they be able to benefit from this acquisition with Mastercard?
Fast rollout,
mm-hmm.
being able to do this within the year or the next year, like
okay.
to have this rolled fully out, right? being able to sell in all markets, Mastercard, they have ground teams everywhere, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we can tap into that kind of distribution, which again allows this to come at consumers' hands much mm-hmm. faster, because I think that's the biggest issue of home banking right now, that we need to push like the speed of delivery to a completely new level, as mm-hmm. we've seen so far, because consumers are actually longing for these things, right? They want simpler ways of being able to pay, more integrated ways where you can do different payment options depending on where you're at. Sometimes you might actually want to use your MasterCard if you're buying travel stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
Other times when you're topping up your saving accounts, you might want to use open banking. Like being able to do all these things when you need them
mm-hmm.
now instead of in 10 years.
Yeah.
I think that's the major benefit of us joining forces here. And the other part is probably like being supported by the MasterCard brand doesn't hurt in terms of consumer adoption either.
Yeah.
Like being able to push our own brand out there is much harder than being able to push it through MasterCard channels.
Of course. And earlier you mentioned that GDPR was almost like a fast track avenue for the expansion of open banking within Europe, of course.
Yeah.
Now you mentioned that you're present in 18 markets within the European Union. Is the acquisition of MasterCard going to propel Aiia services globally? And if so, what vehicles similar to GDPR exist in other areas that could help smooth that transition?
So they already have a net in the US.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we would probably see, like post acquisition, that we will start to kind of build an integration between those two nets, right? Making MasterCard one of the first companies to go truly global with open banking.
Yeah.
Allowing US companies to really fast also onboard the European market and vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's in itself is really exciting.
Absolutely.
And what Finicity built before MasterCard kind of acquired them was something similar as we built before GDPR
uh-huh.
was in place here in
right.
Europe, right? So they always took the stance that you need to be in control of your own sharing.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it won't work that we build a system on top of your bank account.
Yeah.
So they have the same kind of data privacy rules set up for themselves and kind of now inherit GDPR.
Mm-hmm.
So I think like pushing a seamless experience of open banking with the same security standards, with the same data sharing protectionism in order to have consumers actually adopt this, I think MasterCard will be the first to drive this to the global space. I think we will concentrate very much on the European space.
Mm-hmm.
It's difficult enough to get the quality there the next coming years, right? And Finicity in the US, and then we probably will start looking at some of the newer, more the next level markets that will be like South America or Asia and stuff like that.
Okay.
South Africa is also booming.
Absolutely. So all of a sudden now Aiia has basically the doors open to bring services to the entire to the entire globe.
Yeah, and vice versa.
Yeah,
there might be services that already is developed at the U.S. soil.
Yeah.
But as value adds that would work perfectly well on top of our rails as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we can start like exchanging technologies, right?
Well, I think that's fascinating, and we're definitely excited to hear where Aiia goes next. We're very excited about the news, and we'll be rooting for you all the way here from Nordic Fintech Magazine.
Yeah.
So, Rune, thank you so much for your time.